Turning the issues a little closer to home, that Taxachusetts moniker the state has been trying to shake for decades may be once again rearing its head. With month after month of regular tax revenues falling well short of expectations, potential new taxes are the talk of at least some parts of the town. Among the ideas, taxing short-term rentals like Airbnb, higher taxes on future marijuana sales, and a surtax on millionaires. Then there's this potential revenue sweetener, a statewide tax on sugary drinks. A few cities already do this around the country, but if Massachusetts makes the move, it'd be the first U.S. state to establish such a tax. So is it a good idea, and will it become law? Joining me to discuss our Democratic State Senator Jason Lewis of Winchester. He's one of the sponsors of that sweet sin tax proposal. Good to see you, Senator.
Hi, Jim.
Republican State Rep Joe McKenna from Webster. Good to meet you, Representative.
Good to be here. Thank you so much for being here.
By my count, I think I read in the Globe, what would raise somewhere in the neighborhood of $250 million annually if it became law. Is it about revenue raising in a tight dollar fiscal environment, or is it about public health, Senator?
Well, for me, it's really about public health, and it's about a strategy to try to get healthcare costs under control. You know, we all eat lots of foods and beverages that are not that good for us, but sugary beverages in particular are harmful to our health. And there's a lot of high-quality studies over the last number of years that have shown a strong link between consumption of sugary beverages, I'm talking sodas, energy drinks, sports drinks, sweetened iced teas, and a variety of harmful health outcomes.
So you hope to discourage consumption of these sort of things,
correct? Tooth decay, exactly. We're trying to bring down the rates of these preventable diseases and contain health care.
Where would the money go? Where would the $250 million go?
Well, in the legislation that I've proposed along with Representative Kay Conn, we would put all of that money into a children's health promotion fund, and that would be go to, for example, providing safe drinking water fountains in our schools, parks and playgrounds, nutrition programs in our preschools.
So related kind of functions.
So, exactly. So you get a double benefit in health because not only do you reduce consumption of sugary beverages, bring down rates of chronic preventable illnesses, but then you also invest the proceeds in programs that improve children's health.
You're a no on this, Representative, right? Why?
Well, whether it's a revenue grab, which I think we can argue that there's some proponent of that, or whether it's behavior direction, you have to raise the question of what's the purpose of the government? Here we are trying to legislate behavior. Do I support drinking soda? No, I personally don't drink soda, and yeah, there are some concerns, but here we are legislating what behaviors people can do. We're a country that believes in freedom and the pursuit of happiness.
Well, a huge part of the tax system in this country is about regulating, convincing behavior. We want you to buy houses, so we give you a huge mortgage deduction. I can go on and on down the list. Do you doubt, by the way, I understand you have a different view of the role of government. Do you doubt that increasing the tax on sugary drinks would decrease the consumption? Because in places like my hometown of Philly and Mexico and elsewhere, it's worked.
Well, it's a nudge. I don't know that you're going to see major action. You're going to see maybe a small decrease, but it's a regressive tax anyway. It's those who have lower incomes and don't have the ability to absorb those small increases here and there that add up.
So I just want to be clear, even if you were convinced it worked, you don't support the notion of raising revenue this way.
Not by forced legislative action.
How about the regressive? There are people like Bernie Sanders, by the way, that hate the pretty progressive character, hate this method of raising revenue for exactly the reason the representative said, because it essentially is regressive. It has a disproportionate impact on poor people. How do you deal with that?
Well, I understand that concern. But I think what we need to recognize is two things. First is that the disease burden, you know, type 2 diabetes, which has more than doubled in Massachusetts over the last 20 years, obesity, two-thirds of our adults are now overweight or obese, heart disease, certain forms of cancer, that disease burden falls disproportionately on our lower-income, vulnerable communities to begin with. And second of all, the proposal, as I mentioned earlier, is to invest all of this revenue, not just in the general fund, but to steer that back into children's health programs, specifically in those communities.
How about that? That's two problems right there. If you're talking about the healthcare side of it, how many things lead to disease, lead to healthcare problems? Are we going to start taxing and legislating every single thing that could cause someone to get sick? Are we going to start going after grains and white bread and carbohydrates and start adding taxes there?
Sorry, are you against old taxes? increases?
Not, I wouldn't say every tax.
Well,
I
let me give an example.
With the marijuana thing, like,
you'd be okay with
teased,
that.
I think okay, that would be okay with
the
that.
The governor is Wren, as we know, Charlie Baker, of your party, Wren, no new taxes. Mm-hmm. He says, I can support a tax on Airbnb because the leveling of the playing field.
And it's
to me, that's a new, isn't that a tax?
Well, it's kind of hard to oppose a policy where the company itself is pretty much begging you to regulate
themselves. So you support that?
I support a form of that. I think the governor's idea of a six-month or a five-month policy where if you're a weekend home rental,
so the
you
answer
just
is
do
you
one
support
day,
some variation.
Yeah,
of that.
Some variation.
Governor
of
also
scaled
no taxes
back.
Proposed a $2,000 per employee fee.
That one I have a problem
fee.
With.
And by the way, when I used to lobby on Beacon Hill, what Republicans used to say is a tax by any name is a tax.
Yeah.
So isn't the governor pulling a fast one on the people of Massachusetts if he's saying, don't worry, that's not really a tax. Don't worry, this other one is not yeah. really a tax. Just call it something
The
else.
Problem he seeks to remedy with that one is certainly there and needs to be addressed, but that tax is, to me, is too onerous.
So he's not playing, is he not playing straight with the people of Massachusetts by supporting that and saying something?
I don't think he's being dishonest. I don't think he's trying to manipulate or kind of hide anything from anyone.
You know, Deval Patrick tried this on more than one occasion, a variation on your theme. It didn't go anywhere. Do you think in this environment when monthly, as I said, revenues are plunging, we don't know what the impact is going to be of a health care bill out of Washington. If it comes, we know it's going to be bad, according to mm-hmm. Charlie Baker. Does this have greater appeal in this environment, not just as a public health thing, because $250 million is $250 million when the bottom's falling out?
Well, a couple things I would say, Jim. First of all, this is actually quite a different proposal than what Deval Patrick supported, which was to just remove the sales tax exemption.
But it's still
just
a tax
soda,
on sugary drinks.
But he included candy and other things.
Okay.
And as I said at the outset, sugary beverages are a uniquely harmful impact on health. There's lots of things that are unhealthy, but that for sugary beverages, we see such a direct link with heart disease, diabetes, et cetera. Second, this proposal that we put forward is actually fairly innovative because it would levy the amount of the tax would actually be based on the sugar content. So very, very high sugary beverages, the tax would be 2 cents
That's
per
happening
ounce.
In other jurisdictions.
Well,
too.
In other places, it's 1 penny per ounce, regardless of the sugar content.
But can you just answer my question because we're out of time? Mm-hmm. Is this more appealing, even if it's a variation on the same theme, because there are revenue problems in the state? It is. Is it not?
Well, yes. I mean, I'll acknowledge that. But on the other hand, what's driving a lot of our problems with revenue is health care costs, right? We were just talking about the governor proposing an assessment on employers. What's driving that is high Medicaid costs.
Do you support that, by the way?
I support not the details exactly of what the government did, but some form of that, because there is a lot of shifting going on from employment to Medicaid. But the fact is that high health care costs are hurting our families, hurting our businesses, squeezing out education spending in our budget. This strategy is a way to address high health care costs.
You got the last 15 seconds.
Yeah, as you were alluding to, the amount of people who are eligible for mass health, or eligible for employer-covered health care, but are getting mass health and have shifted that cost, that needs to be addressed, which is, you know,
what the fee does, theoretically, or taxes, I would call it. Good to see you, Senator.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Good to see you, too.
Thank you very much, Jim.
Thanks for your time. I appreciate it.